Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
To study with you a very sacred subject. Now, everything that we study about in our worship services is sacred. But perhaps there are some things that impress themselves more upon our minds as being sacred. And where preachers really feel like they're not worthy to talk about, but we would have a guilty conscience if we didn't talk about it. And I want to talk to you about one of those subjects this morning. So before we begin, I want to pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study from His holy book. Let's kneel as far as possible. Father in heaven, we come to you humbly, recognizing that we will not understand spiritual things or divine things unless your Holy Spirit opens the eyes of our understanding, unless your Spirit opens it up to our minds so that we can understand. And we humbly pray that your Spirit will speak to us and enlighten us, that we might understand what we read and study and be able to put it into practice in our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we begin, I want to tell you a story. This is a story that happened many years ago. I don't know exactly how many years ago, but it had already happened many years before when I was told this story, a little over 40 years ago. So this story happened a long time ago, but it did happen in the 20th century. And this story happened to one of my favorite preachers when I was a child. I heard this preacher preach many times. And a little over 40 years ago, I was in a large meeting of ministers, Seventh-day Adventist ministers. There were conference presidents in this meeting, at least one union conference president in this meeting, and a whole bunch of Adventist ministers. And Elder H.M.S. Richards was invited, had been invited there to speak to us. And he told us many things, but here is a story that he told us. And this is a story that happened to him many years before this. He told us, he says, there was a time when Adventist preachers were afraid to travel on airplanes. Now, we laugh about that now. Everybody laughs about that now, and he did too. By the way, H.M.S. Richards was one of the first Adventist preachers that decided it would be a good idea to fly, go by airplane and save time. And other people thought he was kind of, you know, we won't say what they thought he was. And so Adventist preachers usually traveled by train in those days, and I think it was by train that he had made this trip. And he had gone to a general conference. Now, a general conference session is a time where delegates from all parts of the world gather together in a meeting. It was a general conference of Seventh-day Adventists. And so he went to this general conference, and he was invited to be one of the evening speakers. Now, not the first night, but the next night, he was to be the evening speaker. He told us, he said, I had worked for 6 weeks on my sermon. And when he got there the first night, there were two things that he had to do the next day. In the morning, about 10 o'clock, he had to speak to many administrators of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, he was the speaker the founder and the speaker of the radio broadcast that is still going on today called The Voice of Prophecy. And he had a terrible time sometimes getting the funding that he needed to make the work of The Voice of Prophecy go forward so that it was a worldwide radio program as it became. And he was very concerned about whether or not he would be able to persuade these Adventist administrators to do what he felt really needed to be done as far as the Voice of Prophecy was concerned. In fact, he referred to them in his story as those hard-headed boys that he would have to deal with. There were some conference president, union president there, and one of them reproved him for that, and he apologized. He says, I'm sorry that I used that expression. I noticed that he never apologized for telling a lie. He just apologized for using that expression. But he had a problem the first night. He knew that the next morning at 10 o'clock that he had to meet with these administrators and try to persuade them of some things in regard to the Voice of Prophecy. But then a terrible thing happened to him. At least it seemed terrible to him. On the first night of the General Conference, the man that was the speaker, he said he took my subject. What he had planned to talk to the people about the next night, that preacher talked to them about the first night. So now he was stuck. He didn't have anything to preach about the next night. And that wasn't the only problem he had. He'd been sitting on a train too long. And back in those days, he told us, once in a while, I used to have trouble with migraine headaches. And he said, I had the most terrible migraine headache. And after that first meeting, he knew he had to meet, had this meeting at 10 o'clock the next morning, and he had to preach the next night. He didn't know what about now. And he decided he had to deal with this migraine headache. He told us, he says, every step I took, it just felt like somebody hit me in the head with a sledgehammer. Bang, bang, bang. And he decided he had to do something about this headache, so he went out to walk. He thought if he would walk, maybe he could walk the headache off. And he told us, he said, I walked all night. Now, I really couldn't think very much, because every time he took a step, he felt his head sledgehammer hit him in the head. Bang, bang, bang. He said, I walked all night. Of course, he was praying a lot that night. He didn't know what he was going to preach about the next night. And the time came, he'd walked all night, and now it was 10 o'clock the next morning. He had to meet these administrators. Didn't know what he was going to do. Been praying all night. He told us, he said, as I was walking in the door for the meeting, every step, sledgehammer, bang, bang, bang. He said, as I was walking in the door, it felt like a hand went across my forehead. And immediately I was okay. He says, I walked in that meeting, and he said, nobody could stand before me. I persuaded them of what needed to be done. And that problem was solved. And he was so happy. God had worked everything out for him. And he felt good. But he still had one problem. That night he had to preach to the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. He had no idea what he was going to speak about. His mind was out of blank. He didn't know what he was going to talk about. The Lord had solved his problem in regard to the radio broadcast and the voice of prophecy. The Lord had taken his headache away. Didn't know what he's going to do. He thought all the rest of that day, all that afternoon, all that evening, and he still didn't know what he was going to speak about. And the time came, he was right up here in the platform like this, and he's sitting in the chair, and the other people were seated by him, and the King's Heralds got up to speak, to sing. When I was a boy, I used to listen to the King's Heralds. It was a male quartet. He used to sing gospel music. And so the King's Heralds, with the voice of prophecy, got up to sing. And they asked, they would sing whatever subject he was going to speak about. And they said, what are you speaking about tonight? He says, I don't know. So they sang a song. Somebody said, what are you going to speak about? I don't know. He said, tell him to sing another song. So they sang another song. I don't remember how many songs they sang. Every time they sing a song, he didn't know what he's going to speak about. He'd have to sing another song. So they sang another song. And finally, they sang this song. They sang a song called The Love of God. You ever heard that song? I am sad, actually, that for some reason, it seems like a large percentage of the times that I've heard that song has been at funeral services. I don't know why we choose to sing that song at funeral services, but we do, and I'm not objecting to it. But The Love of God is a wonderful song. We should sing it at other times than at funeral services. And he told us in this meeting, I was at the meeting, he said they were on the last line of the last stanza of this song, The Love of God, and all of a sudden it came to me what I was to speak about. So he got up and he spoke. Now, he told us what he spoke about. Now, I can't preach like HMS Richards could preach, but I can read you the scripture that he spoke about that night. Would you like to read it? Okay, open your Bible to Romans 1. We'll read the scripture that he preached to the General Conference that night. Romans 1. We are going to read from verses 14 to 16. This was the passage of Scripture he studied with the General Conference that night. He told us, the power of God came on him, so he said, I had the audience in my hand just a moment. Of course, HMS Richards could do those kind of things. Remember, the sermon that he preached has 3 points. We're going to study the 3 points. The sermon has 3 points, so I'll tell you what it is before we get started so you can get it in your mind. The sermon has 3 points, and the points are this. Now look at the scripture, and you're going to see what the points are. The points are, I am a debtor. Number two, I am ready. And number three, I am not ashamed. Those are the points of the sermon. I am a debtor. I am ready. I am not ashamed. All right, let's read the scripture. It says, I am a debtor both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to wise and to unwise. So, as much as is in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation. For everyone who believes, for the Jew first, and also for the Greek. What did Paul mean when he said, I am a debtor? It's not complicated. Paul knew the gospel of Jesus Christ, and he knew that if a person would accept it, that that person would have eternal life. He also knew that if a person rejected it and refused it, that person would have eternal death. You see, the gospel is something that determines whether you have eternal life or eternal death. And Paul knew that all these people around him in the Roman Empire, whether they were Greeks or barbarians, a barbarian, by the way, is anybody that's not a Greek. That takes everybody in the world. The Greeks are like everybody of the nationality. They believe that they were the best nationality in the world, so they called everybody that wasn't a Greek a barbarian. And so when you say the Greeks and the barbarians, that's everybody in the world. If you're not a Greek person from the Greek standpoint, then you're a barbarian. That's the way they reasoned. So the Greeks and the barbarians take in everybody in the world. He said, I'm a debtor to all of them. Why? Because they didn't know the gospel. And he did know the gospel. And he knew that if he told them the gospel and they accepted it, that they would have eternal life. Now think this through. If I know something that could give you eternal life and you don't know about it, if I love my neighbor as myself, do I owe it to you to see that you find out about it? Do I? Remember, there's only 2 tables in the law, Jesus said. They'll hold the first 4 commandments on one, the last 6 commandments on the other. The first one is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. The second part of the law is to love your neighbor as yourself. If I know the gospel and you don't know it, if I don't tell you, am I loving you as I love myself? Absolutely not. And so, he says, I'm a debtor. Who am I a debtor to? I'm a debtor to all these people that don't know the gospel. I know it. They don't know it. So I'm a debtor to see that they find out about it. And Paul traveled all over the Roman world. Historians differ in their records, and I don't know who's right. I've read historians who say that in the time of Christ there were about 120 million people living in the Roman Empire. I've read other historians say that at that time in the whole world there were 250 million people living. I don't know who's right or how many people there were. I don't even know if they have accurate numbers. But that's what they think. But at least half, and maybe more than half, of the world population lived in the Roman Empire. That was the civilized world. There were a few people that lived in other places. We know that Thomas, one of the disciples, went down to India and preached the gospel in India. So there were people that went to different places. And
And Philip preached the gospel to the eunuch from Ethiopia, and the gospel there by went to Ethiopia. By the way, there were Sabbath keepers in Ethiopia clear up in the 15th and 16th century that went all the way back to the apostles. But Paul said, I'm a debtor to all these people that don't know because I know. And so, because I'm a debtor, note what he says in verse 15, so as much as is in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome also. I'm ready. And friends, it's a sad, sad thing that there are a lot of Christians today that aren't ready. They believe that the gospel should be preached. They believe that the three angels' messages should be taken to the whole world. But they're not ready to do it. They think somebody should do it, but they're not ready to do it. Why are they not ready to do it? Well, there's several reasons. Number one, when you go out as a gospel worker, that involves risk. It involves lots of risk. It involves risk of travel. Paul says that he was a shipwreck three times. He said, I spent a night and a day in the ocean, in the sea. He talks about several times he got beat up, one time he got stoned. There's some risk involved in taking the gospel to the world. We have a gospel worker right now that's been to other parts of the world and came home the other day and got some stomach problem because he contacted something in this other country. See, he wouldn't have contacted that if he stayed home. See, there's risk involved in taking the gospel. And so, because there's risk involved in taking the gospel, there's some people that aren't ready. They're waiting for somebody else to do it. In fact, there's so many people like that that that's why the gospel goes slowly. Because there's so many Christians that aren't ready. But Paul said, I am ready. I'm ready right now. As much as in me is, I'll do it. I'll take it. I'll preach it. Well, somebody's probably saying, well, Pastor John, that doesn't apply to me because I'm not a preacher. Wait a minute. Do you not have any, if you know the gospel, do you not have any responsibility to help other people find out? Because you're not a preacher? Think about it this way. We have airplanes today that only have two people up front, a pilot and a co-pilot. A few years ago, we used to have three and four. I've had friends that were pilots in World War II. In fact, one was a navigator. He flew missions over Germany in a bomber, World War II. He was a navigator. Suppose the navigator were to say, because I'm not the pilot, I just don't think I'll participate. What would happen? You see, in God's work, just like in an airplane or a ship that goes on the ocean or a business or a ministry or a church, God has work for everybody, not all the same kind. Do you read about that in the Bible? Oh my, you read a lot about that in the Bible. There was a woman one time, and she was thought to not be all that talented, probably not a public speaker, but she said, there's something I can do. I can make clothes. And so, then, just as now, there were people that were poor and needed clothes. And so she made clothes for people that needed clothes. Is that important or not important? Well, let me tell you how important that was. When that woman died, and the people went talked to the Apostle Peter about it. He came to where she was and prayed over her, and the Lord raised her up again. She is one of just a few people recorded in the sacred record that after she died, the Lord said, no, she's not going to die. She's going to live again. Her name was Dorcas. We have Dorcas societies today to help people that are in trouble. Are those people just as important as the preachers? Well, of course they are. You see, there are many different kinds of work in God's service that can be used to get the three angels' messages to the world. I receive letters from people that say, well, I'm retired, I'm shut in, what can I do? I'll send you this tithe and offering so that if those people didn't send us that tithe and offering, we would not be able to send gospel workers and ministers and Bible workers to different parts of the world. Is what they're doing important? It's very important. God has a work for everybody. And so, don't say that you're not included. You're included. There's a place for you in God's plan. The only thing you need to ask is, Lord, what is the place that you want me to fill? What do you want me to do? And if you ask the Lord that, the Lord will show you something. I've seen that happen over and over again. If you're not working in God's service, remember what Paul said? He said, I'm ready. I'm ready. Are you ready? Or are you waiting? And then he said, I'm a debtor. I'm ready. And I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Now, a lot of people today say, well, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ either because it's not a reproach to be a Christian anymore. I'm in a Christian country, so I'm not ashamed of the gospel either. Let me ask you this question. Do you know what the gospel is? One of the reasons there are so many people today that say that they're not ashamed of the gospel anymore is because they don't really know what the gospel is. If they really knew what the gospel is, they wouldn't be so quick to make the comments that they make about it. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. Now, Paul was ready to preach the gospel. He said, with as much as in me is to everybody, to the people in Rome and anybody else, the Greeks, the barbarians, everybody. But remember, maybe there's somebody that you were in contact with that I'm not in contact with that God wants you to give the gospel. Now, you can't give the gospel to somebody if you don't know what it is. So, let's spend a minute or two or three in answering that question. What is the gospel? Now, the gospel can be explained many different ways, different language, different preachers, different people in the Bible explain it in different language. The way I'm going to explain it is not the only way to explain it. But I'm going to explain it to you in one sentence, and it's not my sentence, actually. This is a sentence that Ellen White wrote in 1895. If you want to look it up, it's in 1888 materials about page 1455. But it's a long sentence, I'm warning you that. It's a long sentence. But it's just one sentence. And this sentence explains what the gospel is. And if you understand this sentence, you understand what the gospel is, and you can explain it to somebody else. I'm warning you in advance that you might need to study this sentence a little bit in order for you to understand it, so you can explain it to somebody. But here's the sentence, I'll read it to you. You'll notice, if you're listening carefully, there are four parts. Here it is. This is what she wrote. These are our themes. Christ crucified for our sins. Christ risen from the dead. Christ our intercessor before God. And closely connected with these is the office work of the Holy Spirit, the representative of Christ, sent forth with divine power and gifts for men. Those are the four parts of the gospel. I love to preach about every one of them. First part is Christ crucified for our sins. We can never study that subject too much. The second part is Christ risen from the dead. I love that. When I was a pastor in North Dakota, I actually got this from HMS Richards, too. I got from him a sermon that he preached about the resurrection, and I said, this is so wonderful, I have to know this and study it, and I'm going to tell the church about it, and I preached a whole sermon on the resurrection of Christ. Oh, the people were just inspired. I love to talk about Christ risen from the dead. That's the second part of the gospel. Paul says that's for our justification. I can talk a long time about that. People in other religions go to the tomb of their founder. Now, you can go to the tomb of our founder too, but the tomb is empty. And the resurrection of Christ from the dead is the proof, the Bible says, that if you belong to Him, you and die, you will rise from the dead too. It's the proof. It cannot be controverted very well, by the way. It's one of the most established facts of both religious and secular history. You don't even need to know the Bible to know about it. It's recorded in secular history. Third part of the gospel. Christ is our intercessor in heaven. Now, during the Dark Ages, people became very confused as a result of false teachers, and they were taught that you needed to go to somebody called a priest, and that the priest would intercede for you in heaven and get your sins forgiven. And when the Protestant Reformation came along in the 16th century, the Protestant reformers had been studying the New Testament, and they said, no, that's all wrong. And there were three major doctrines of the Reformation. And one of those three major doctrines of the Protestant Reformation that we still believe is what is called the priesthood of the believers. And that, by the way, do you know who first taught, as far as we know, the doctrine of the priesthood of the believers? The Apostle Peter. Oh, I love it that he was the first one that taught it. But anyway, that's something you can study on your own too. The Apostle Peter is the first one that taught the doctrine of the priesthood of the believers. Reads 1 Peter 2. And so the Protestant reformers said, we're all priests. If you're a Christian, you're all priests. And that's what Peter taught. Read 1 Peter 2. But we have one great high priest, and Paul said there's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. He wrote that to Timothy. And so you can go directly to Jesus in heaven and confess your sins, and He will forgive your sins. You do not need to go to a human priest to get your sins forgiven. By the way, I don't forgive anybody's sins. I'm not a priest in the sense that a Roman Catholic clergyman is a priest. I don't take confessions from people. I don't tell them that I'm absolving their sins, because I know that Jesus in heaven is going to do that. And you can go directly to Him, and He will take away your guilt and the power of sin in your life. That's the third part of the gospel. But did you know that all of that together is not enough for you to be saved? Did you notice when we read the gospel had four parts? Did you notice what the fourth part was? What was it? It was the office work of the Holy Spirit. Now let me read to you from the Bible how important that is. Turn in your Bible to the Gospel of John, the third chapter, and the fifth verse. This is what Jesus is speaking to Nicodemus. It says, Jesus answered, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Have you read that verse enough times so the meaning has really sunk into your mind? Jesus said, if you're not born of water and what? The Spirit. If you are not born of the Spirit, can you be saved? What does it say? You cannot. This is strong language, isn't it? If you're not born of the Spirit, you cannot be saved. You won't be in heaven. Well, then, is this an important part of the gospel? It's a very important part of the gospel. So, I want to study with you for a few minutes that we have left the fourth part of the gospel. You can't explain it to somebody else if you don't understand it yourself. The fourth part of the gospel is the office work of the Holy Spirit. Now, we live in a world where there are a lot of people that are always wanting to know something new. There are preachers like this too. I've known a lot of them. There's a lot of people that they're like the Athenians. The Bible says they're always trying to figure out some new doctrine, some new teaching. So there's people that think, well, if I can receive the Holy Spirit, then I'll learn and know some new things. That is not what we're going to talk about. Let me read to you what Ellen White wrote about that. She said, "It is not the office work of the Holy Spirit to reveal new truths." That's not what we're going to talk about. It's not to find out something new. That's not it. Well, what is it then? "But to present to the mind and urge upon the conscience the precious lessons which Christ has given in the Old and New Testament." Now, I want to read to you, this is a fairly long paragraph, and in the rest of our time together, I am going to be spending more time reading than I sometimes do. The reason for that is, what we're talking about is so sacred and so holy, I don't even want to talk to you in my own language. I want to read it to you for inspired language, so you can take it from that. But I want to read to you a statement in the book Desire of Ages that is one of the most powerful paragraphs in all the Spirit of Prophecy. It's Desire of Ages, page 671. I had a teacher when I was a freshman in college that the last sentence of this paragraph she told us all over and over again, so I can still remember it. But the whole paragraph is powerful because it explains what the office work of the Holy Spirit is. This is Desire of Ages, page 671. This is what it says. "In describing to his disciples the office work of the Holy Spirit, Jesus sought to inspire them with the joy and hope that inspired his own heart. He rejoiced because of the abundant help he had provided for his church. The Holy Spirit was the highest of all gifts that he could solicit from his Father for the exaltation of his people. The Spirit was to be given as a regenerating agent, and without this, the sacrifice of Christ would have been of no avail. The power of evil had been strengthening for centuries, and the submission of men to this satanic captivity was amazing. Sin could be resisted and overcome only through the mighty agency of the third person of the Godhead, who would come with no modified energy, but in the fullness of divine power. It is the Spirit that makes effectual what has been wrought out by the world's Redeemer. It is by the Spirit that the heart is made pure. Through the Spirit, the believer becomes a partaker of the divine nature. Christ has given his Spirit as a divine power to overcome all hereditary and cultivated tendencies to evil and to impress his own character upon his church." Now, you go home and read that sometime, this afternoon or sometime. Desire of Ages, page 671. It's powerful. You have to read it several times before it starts to hit you over and over again with how powerful the language is. It's by the Spirit, it says, that the heart is made pure. Sin can be resisted and overcome only through the Holy Spirit. Have you ever met somebody that's struggling with some kind of a sin problem, and they say to you, "You know, I've tried 100 times to overcome this, and I can't do it"? Don't argue with them. They're telling you the truth. They can't overcome it. They'll never overcome it unless they receive the Holy Spirit. And when a person is born of the Spirit, when they're baptized with the Holy Spirit, then they have divine power to do what they couldn't do before. Have you ever met somebody that was just addicted to some sin? Now, it really doesn't matter what kind of sin it is. When you get addicted, we're not going to go now into how addiction and how it works and what it is and all of that, but you know what addiction is. Addiction is when a habit has control of you so bad that you can't quit it. Some people are addicted to drugs. Some people are addicted to alcohol. Some people are addicted to tobacco. Other people are addicted to pornography or some other kind of sin. And people are addicted to these things, and they can't get free. And they say, "You know, I had a man say to me one time, he said, I'd like to be a Seventh-day Adventist, but I can't." I said, "Why can't you?" His wife was a Seventh-day Adventist. He says, I'd like to be, but I can't." "Well, why can't you?" "Because I can't quit smoking." Now, by the way, I wish that was the only time in the world that I'd ever met somebody like that. That's just one time. Anybody here and you're addicted to something and you know it's wrong and you can't get free? And so every night you're saying, "Oh, Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins." But you do it the next day, and the next night you're feeling so bad, you say, "Oh, Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins." Now, the Lord Jesus is happy to forgive you. But if you're going to the kingdom of heaven, you have to be delivered from that. How are you going to get delivered? We just read it. Only through the power of the third person of the Godhead can sin be overcome. And when I have a sin problem in my life and I can't overcome it, what do I need to be praying for? I need to be praying, say, "Lord, I want to receive the Holy Spirit in my life so that I can live a different life." Does God want you to be able to live a different life free from sin? Well, yes, friends, that's why the Holy Spirit's promised. Now, let's review for just a moment. If you receive the Holy Spirit, did you know that most people that say that they want to receive the Holy Spirit don't really want to receive the Holy Spirit? That's true. I'm going to show you. Because here is the first thing that happens when a person receives the Holy Spirit. I'll read it. I won't give you my own language. Here's what happened. The great office work of the Holy Spirit is thus distinctly specified by our Savior. And she quotes now from John 16. We read it in our scripture. "And when He is come, He will reprove the world of sin." Let me ask you this question. Do people like to be reproved concerning their sins? No, they don't. But as soon as the Holy Spirit comes, if you have sin in your life, you are going to be reproved by the Holy Spirit. People don't like that. That's why most people, most Christians, most professed Christians do not want to receive the Holy Spirit. They want to receive a spirit, all right, but not the Holy Spirit. Because as soon as the Holy Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit reproves them of their sins, and they don't like that. Let me read you another statement here about that very thing. It shows that most people don't want to receive the Holy Spirit. This is a fairly long one, but it's interesting. It says, "There was but one remedy by which man could be saved. Man must believe God's word and follow the example of humility and meekness of heart. Jesus leads the minds of men from their worldly philosophy and self-exalting sentiments to the purity and virtue of the gospel. He leads them away from their false religions of fancy and human reason. There is a religion in the world that is apparently beautiful, but which leads men to turn with disgust from the representation given by Christ of the office work of the Holy Spirit, of the Comforter which He was to send to His disciples." He says, "And when He is come, He will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. The natural heart does not enjoy the constant reproving of sin and continual exalting of righteousness. Men feel disgusted when they are represented as helpless to do good. Yet Jesus declares, 'Without me you can do nothing.' The Word of God requires humility and practical godliness. And the picture of man's dependence upon God is mortifying to the selfish independence of man, to his grand ideas of eloquence and finery and parade. Notice, when the Holy Spirit comes to people, what happens? They're disgusted. Why are they disgusted? Because they don't like to be reproved of their sins. You still want to receive the Holy Spirit? Friend, if you want to receive the Holy Spirit, you need to start praying and say, Lord, help me to endure every rebuke that you have for me. Did you get that? If you really want to receive the Holy Spirit, you need to pray and say, Lord, help me to endure every rebuke that you have for me. Because when the Holy Spirit comes, you're going to be reproved and rebuked if you have any sin in your life. Now, it's the lack of the Holy Spirit that results in us having all kinds of trouble in churches and institutions. Because, well, let me read that one too. Until the Holy Spirit is accepted and allowed to do its office work upon the heart, each individual will strive to become a center of influence for himself. Oh, friend, that is human nature. You ever heard a little child say, me first? You ever heard that? Now, we're adults. We don't do that anymore, right? Until the Holy Spirit comes, she says, every human being is trying to make a center of influence of himself. I want people to see what I do. We have all kinds of ways of doing it. When people build houses and buy cars and start businesses and buy clothes and all kinds of things, what are they doing it for? Well, they want to be a center of influence. And if you receive the Holy Spirit, you won't be a center of influence anymore. Your life will be centered somewhere else than yourself. And that is not popular. Just look around. But I want to talk just a moment about what could happen. What could happen in your home, in your family, in the church? What could happen if we receive the Holy Spirit? What would the Holy Spirit do? Now, we've looked about why people don't want to receive the Holy Spirit, because they're going to get rebuked of their sins. But what if I decide, well, Lord, by your grace, I'm going to endure whatever rebuke you have for me. I want to receive the Holy Spirit anyway. Even though I get rebuked every day, I want to receive the Holy Spirit anyway. What would happen? Well, here's what would happen. The great questions of Bible truth are to enter into the very heart of society, to convert and reform men and women, and bringing them to see the great need of preparing for the mansions that Christ declared He would prepare for all who love Him. When the Holy Spirit shall do its office work, hearts of stone will become hearts of flesh, and Satan will not work through them to counteract the work that Christ came to earth to do. She says, when the Holy Spirit comes, when the Holy Spirit works on a person, the result will be they won't have a heart of stone anymore. And by the way, this is an allusion to Ezekiel 36. You can look it up in your Bible. Ezekiel 36, 26. The Lord said, I'm going to put my Spirit upon you, and I'm going to take away your heart of stone, and I'm going to give you a heart of flesh. That's what the prophet said. And she says, when the Holy Spirit comes, that's what's going to happen. It's just as true now as when Ezekiel wrote it. If you receive the Holy Spirit, your heart of stone is going to be taken out, and you're going to receive a heart of flesh. You're going to be able to feel. By the way, have you ever had to deal with a human being that had a heart of stone? Well, maybe there's some children here that have never had to deal with a human being that had a heart of stone. Let me just tell you this much for those of you that are children. If you ever have to deal with a human being that has a heart of stone, you'll wish you didn't. You wish you didn't have to deal with that person. Is it possible? Evidently, HMS Richards felt that way. Before he got rebuked, he called them hard-headed boys that he had to deal with. But by the way, those hard-headed boys were the leader of the Adventist ministers, leaders of the Adventist ministry. So maybe we do have a problem with having hearts of stone. Maybe we do. But what could happen if there was nobody left in your family, if there was nobody left in the church that had a heart of stone, everybody had a heart of flesh? What could happen? You know what would happen? What would happen is, if that happened in your home, when people came up to the threshold to walk in your home, Ellen White says that as soon as they stepped over the threshold into your home, they would feel it's different here. The same thing would happen in the church. As soon as people came through the door, you wouldn't need to say anything. They would feel it. They'd say it's different. Do you and I need to pray that we'll receive the Holy Spirit and endure the rebuke so that we can have a heart of flesh instead of a heart of stone? Is it something worth going through a little pain to get? It is. It is. Now, the Holy Spirit, like all other members of the Godhead, is polite. No member of the Godhead will force his way into your heart. You remember the text in the Bible where Jesus said in Revelation 3, "Behold, I stand at the door and what? Knock." There are people in this world that have hearts of stone, and they will just came right into your house, invited or not. And you better accept them, or you'll be in trouble. You better do whatever they say. That happens all the time. We call them break-ins and robbers and thieves and all that kind of stuff. They don't knock at the door. They just figure out a way to get in. God is not like that. That's the devil's way of acting. Jesus said, "I stand at the door and knock." What's he waiting for? Oh, he's waiting for you to open the door. How long is he going to wait? Let me read you a statement about this. The Holy Spirit is ever waiting. It's quite a statement. It's ever waiting. What's it waiting for? Oh, it's waiting for a human being to open up and say, "Yes, I'm willing to be reproved for my sins. I'm willing to have a change of heart. I want everything you have for me. I surrender to you. I don't want to be the center of things anymore." So the question is, how long do you want the Holy Spirit to wait? If you haven't opened up the door of your heart to Jesus, remember, the Holy Spirit is the representative in our world of Jesus Christ. Many statements on that. We won't take time to read those right now. How long do you want the Holy Spirit to wait before you open the door so that you can have a change of heart, so that you can have a heart of flesh, not a heart of stone? And remember, the Holy Spirit will not just change your heart. The Holy Spirit will give you power to live a life that you can never do on your own. The Holy Spirit will protect you. You're all aware of the fact that we live in a world that right now is occupied by hostile forces. We have no idea how many evil angels that the devil has at his command. The Bible talks a lot about it. In fact, the Bible says that 1/3 of the angels of heaven fell with Lucifer, and they're down here in this world. And the Bible calls them evil spirits and evil angels. And these angels have the ability to torment us, both physically and mentally, and cause us all kinds of trouble, both mental and physical sickness. But let me read you something interesting about that. "Shall we bear in mind that the presence of the Holy Spirit with us in the bedchamber, in the family circle, in the most difficult places we pass through, is shielding us from the shafts of the enemy, constantly counterworking his devices and carrying forward his work as a reprover of sin, imparting and impressing the mind with the words of Christ." Oh, friend, the Holy Spirit wants to shield you from the demonic attacks that we are all subject to. Would you like to have some divine protection? If we weren't out of time, I would be severely tempted right now to tell you some stories, but we're not going to. Pastor Domingo can tell you some stories, and I can tell you some stories, and my wife can tell you some stories of time when we know that we were shielded from certain disaster. But the Lord said, no, you're going to be shielded. We didn't get scratched. We could have been killed. Do you need divine protection in your life? You need the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is what brings that divine protection. That's what she says here. Shields us from the shafts of the enemy. Well, what we need more than anything else. Now, there's people that I talk to often that tell me about all kinds of things they need. I talk to people and they write into us. They say, oh, help me. I need to find a job. Help me. I need to overcome this evil habit. Help me. I'm in financial trouble. So people have come to us with all kinds of needs. But let me tell you what you need more than anything else. You need to receive the Holy Spirit. You know why? If you receive the Holy Spirit, you're going to receive every other blessing that God has for you, including eternal life. I hope that's appealing to you. We're just about out of time, and I'm not adequate to speak about or explain this subject. But in closing, I want to read to you a statement Ellen White wrote. It's in the 1888 materials, page 1249, and it's about our great need of receiving the Holy Spirit. Remember, friend, if you receive the Holy Spirit, you're going to receive from God everything else that you need. Here it is. The Lord will enrich the minds of those who are searching for the hidden treasures of truth. What promise did our Lord Jesus Christ make to His disciples to furnish them with consolation in view of His departure from them? It was the promise of the Holy Spirit of God. The divine influence of the Holy Spirit was to cooperate with the human mind and to bring to their remembrance whatsoever Christ had spoken to them. Now listen to the next sentence. The great need of this time of peril is the Holy Spirit, for it will bring to the receiver all other blessings in its train. The truth believed will transform the character. In the light of the truth that is shining in our day, we are reproved for the dearth of the Holy Spirit. This lack is an evidence that there is not an abundance of that faith which works by love and purifies the soul. As long as individuals are content with a theory of the truth and are yet lacking in the daily operation of the Spirit of God upon the heart, which is manifested in outward transformation of character, they are cutting themselves off from the qualification that would fit them for greater efficiency in the Master's work. She goes on to say, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you can't be an efficient messenger, you can't be a preacher, you can't be a minister, you can't do evangelism, you can't do God's work unless you have the Holy Spirit. But if you have the Holy Spirit, now I don't know what problem you're dealing with right now. I know in a group like this big that there's different individuals that are dealing with all kinds of problems. But remember, if you need help in dealing with the problems you're dealing with, then you need the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit will bring you divine help. We're out of time. I can't tell stories about how God intervenes at just the right time. But God's timing is never off. And my dear friend, if you are in need, and you know that you're in need, And if you want salvation, remember, there is no salvation except as you're born of the Holy Spirit. That's what Jesus said to Nicodemus. But you can have the Holy Spirit if you make a surrender of your heart to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You can receive the Holy Spirit today. Would you like to receive the Holy Spirit into your life? You willing to be reproved of your sins? If you'd like to, let's kneel down and pray about it. Father in heaven, I come to you as a weak, faltering human being that has read your promises in your word, that if we would ask, we would receive the Holy Spirit, and that then we would receive everything else that we need to be saved. And Lord, I pray for each person here. You know what we don't know. What's going on in the heart of every man, woman, and child? You know the inward struggles that nobody else knows about. But Lord, you have provided divine power for every crisis, every situation that we deal with. And I pray for each one here that is reaching out to you. I intercede for each one that as we say in our heart, Lord, I want to receive the Holy Spirit, we pray that you will hear our cry and that your Spirit will speak to us. And that your Spirit will not only reprove us of sin, but that we may receive power to overcome and to do your will, so that we might be among that group that is saved by the blood of the Lamb and by the regeneration of the Holy Spirit. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.